Hello and welcome. I am Deborah Vermillion, Technical Specialist at Microsoft. This video is an expansion of the Dynamics 365 financial topics presented in the shorter teaser video. Customers migrating from older versions of Dynamics AX will benefit from major improvements made to Dynamics over the last 12 years, plus can avoid some risk and expense of adding extensions and ISV applications. You can find more about our migration assessment program at aka.ms/D365migrate. Following up on the teaser video, I will drill down into these highlighted topics. Let's get started first with financial dimensions. The expansion of the financial framework to handle shared chart of accounts, unlimited financial dimensions, and introduction of account structures were a major benefit for the financial framework flexibility and posting accuracy. Those on AX 2009 will appreciate no longer needing a virtual company to get the benefit of shared tables across legal entities. In AX 2009, you were limited to 3 dimensions with a max of 10. Starting in AX 2012, unlimited dimensions were introduced, including user-defined dimensions as well as table value-driven dimensions. To manage this flexibility, rather than just a fixed order of dimensions with AX 2009, the account structure was introduced. This provides a definition of what dimensions can be used with what accounts and if any constraints on entry are in place. It also provided ability to have advanced rules. The advanced rules specify that on a specific account or a range of accounts that in this case shown here, that the project dimension, which is a derived from a project table, will be a required entry. This controls the dynamic nature of entry relative to specific accounts. Another feature allows users to derive certain dimensions based on the previous dimension in the account stream. This is different than the account structure configuration because the derived dimension is a suggestion as opposed to something mandatory. The derived dimension along with the account structure, whether it's general journal entries or manual AP invoices, this suggestion mechanism could greatly improve your company's ability to enter the correct financial dimension, thus providing more accurate and intelligent reporting. This leads me to mention another key enhancement for more intelligent reporting, our Financial Insights workspace. With drill down to the source journal that is accumulated in that report. Embedded analytical Power BI report enhancements offers intelligent reporting beyond what Management Reporter offered in AX 2009 and what AX 2012 role pages provided. Definitely another one of my favorites. Expanding on our next topic, credit and collections workspace. As I mentioned in the teaser, a huge benefit of the new UI is the workspaces. The credit and collection, actionable tabs, key visuals, and embedded analytics provide immediate feedback to status and potential collection problem areas. The balances can be changed here on the fly with flexible aging periods, also balances by pool or status. Sliding right on the workspace, I have a list views. Here I can see overdue customers, age balances, credit limits, customers on hold, credit cases, activities that I need to complete. From the age balance list view, I can visually see age status indicators based on the balance period that I have defined to quickly see credit potential issues. I can create activities, update aging, and send email statements to the customer right from this list. Drilling into the collection details, I can see any open cases for the customer, open transactions, and open activities. I can create new cases to manage that collection process across multiple parties. I can also change the status, write off, or settle the open transactions right from this screen. Changing the status can send an email to a salesperson that the status has changed. You can also schedule appointments and tasks associated with this collection, and that can get synchronized to your Outlook calendar. Auto-sync to your calendar for visibility wherever you are working. This 360 view of all the related collection activities and communication tasks put everything your collection agent needs at their fingertips. Again, the enhanced embedded analytical workspaces for collection overview statistics and status on aging and collection activities, as well as the ability to drill down from the bucket to what makes up that number, is key to providing management with total visibility of the collection process. Now let's look further at the credit management aspect with our new credit management module that came out this year. This module helps to proactively suggest credit control activities. Let's start with the customer credit limit management. In the customer master record on the credit and collections tab, we have always had a credit limit for the customer, but now we have some additional limits. We can have a portion that is covered by insurance and guarantees. That credit limit can be shown in the customer's currency. We have temporary credit limits. We also have new dates to control the review and expiration of the credit limits, as well as rules for expiration. We're tracking a new account status, which can also provide a rule to when to hold invoices and a reason for that status. We can track the year the business was established, as well as how long they've been a customer of ours. This impacts the risk score assigned to the customer. Talk about that in a bit. Looking to the right, there's a lot of new credit statistics for the customer. DSO, average payment days, average balances, credit rating, risk score, and the average percent of the credit limit. For credit limit management, we also have credit groups. These customers can share the credit limit across the group. It also works across legal entities. If you belong to a group, the entire group is checked first against the group credit limit, and then it checks the individual customers for temporary credit and their credit limit to see if over. From the credit group, you can also get an age balance report specific to that group. To make credit limit adjustments, you can now do that through a journal, which provides detailed traceability, but you also have the ability to automatically set credit limit based on risk criteria or to mass change based on credit group, as well as use workflows to manage the review and the change process. Risk assessments are based on customer attributes. You can establish scoring groups on how you want to score a range like number of years, a customer, or a specific value like D&B rating or country located that may impact the risk score. You can see exactly how a customer score is calculated from their risk score assessment page with the scoring group factors. Another major feature of credit management is order holds. Ability to rank payments and discount terms. If changes to a higher rank, that creates a hole. Ability to set rules to block orders due to days overdue, account status, terms of payment, credit limit expired, overdue amount, or the value on the sales order. These rules can apply either to all customers or to a specific customer credit group or to individual customers. This can be a block of orders or to exclude orders from being blocked. A new addition to the parameters for credit collection allows you to specify when to check the credit limits and if there is a grace period. If those grace days have passed before the next posting, it will recheck again. All these rules are checked at order entry confirmation step, and if an issue, it will give a message and automatically send the order to the credit collections list for management and review. Here, the order can be manually updated to release or rejected, or it can be evaluated automatically to see if conditions have changed and release it. Microsoft's new credit management module can help improve cash flow and reduce bad debts. I mentioned this in the teaser video. One of my favorite workspaces is the financial period close workspace. This workspace lets you track all those financial closing tasks and processes across companies, areas, and people. Associated with each person can be a detailed task list that they are responsible for completing during the month-end close process. They can add attachments for supporting documents or notes to each task. These tasks can be constructed with dependencies, so a task cannot be completed if dependent tasks have not been completed first. That includes tasks across companies. They can run and complete the task right from their task list, all in one place. This increased efficiency in tracking allows your company to close books faster and make key financial decisions quicker. Let's look at revenue recognition. Revenue recognition module was added to assist companies that must comply with the regulations of ASC 606. This typically applies to industries requiring revenue management for multi-element billing, like high tech or software, pharmaceutical, life sciences, cloud-based models, service industries, any business that bundles or packages products and services. The first step is knowing the terms of the contract with the customer. From those terms, you can develop a revenue schedule. Included in the schedule is the occurrence of the revenue. Does it occur once, which might relate to an installation service? Does it occur over multiple months, like support contracts or insurance? How is the contract start and end date set? Are they set automatically? This can be done based on the revenue type, which is set on the release products detail. The start contract date for the lines on the order is typically the ship date, and the contract's end date is determined from the number of months or occurrences that is defined in this revenue schedule. The recognition basis is how the revenue price is allocated across the occurrences. Is it monthly by actual days in the month, or is it equally across the number of months, or equally across the number of occurrences? What date will be defaulted on the revenue schedule for the invoice? Is it the actual start date of the contract, or is it the first of the month, or is it a mid-month split, where if it's in the 1st through the 15th, it will be the first of that month, or if it's in the 16th through the end of the month, it will be the first day of the next month, or you can set it to be the first day of the next month. The detailed revenue schedule is calculated and provides a view to the general periods and percentages that will be recognized in each period. This form can be edited, but percentages must total 100%. Another key piece, as I mentioned, is the setup on the release products detail for your revenue-related items. Here you can define the revenue schedule, the revenue type, and define how the price will be determined for revenue recognition. Normally, you set the option to include the release product in the revenue allocation calculation to yes. If this option is set to no, the release product uses the median price method if the median price is defined. If the median price isn't defined, the unit price on the sales order line is used to post revenue or deferred revenue. Median price tolerance and how to use those tolerance can also be set here. The setup of the median price is in the revenue prices on the sale action ribbon. Here I am starting the revenue process from the sales order. The revenue schedule, contract dates, and occurrences are assigned to each line on the order. Based on the order elements, there could be revenue schedules, deferrals, and reallocations. All the key information and tasks to manage the revenue recognition shown here are located on the revenue recognition workspace. This concludes our topics for this session. Please note on this list many more topics that are improvements made over the last 12 years since AX 2009. Thank you again for your time. You can find more about our migration assessment program at aka.ms/D365migrate.